Hello YouTubers, and welcome to the first in this series that I'm starting called Take a Look Inside. So I didn't think I'd actually film this, but I had a need to jump inside this kind of emergency light. It's an LED based light which you plug into the mains electricity. It recharges a battery inside, and then if you have a power failure, it automatically comes on and illuminates. Now, these, I bought several of these from a camping store in South Africa. They have been quite useful in that regard. In years gone by, we used to have quite a few rolling power failures, so these were quite handy. They automatically come on. You can either select from just four LED units up here or this big array over here. But obviously over time, the battery being permanently charged, and I don't know the quality of the charger inside this, it dies. There are no screws to get into it, and the reason I want to try and get into this to see if I can bring this one back to life is we had a scenario yesterday. As you'll know, I've got solar power on the house. We had a scenario yesterday where there was a general power failure in the area, and we didn't know, because obviously our power stayed on. We're all running off the inverter and the batteries. But in that situation, I kind of need to know that there's a power failure, because then perhaps I need to be more conservative in how we're using our power in case it's a prolonged power outage. So what I intend to do is try and get this working again. It'll be a hack. It certainly will be a hack, I think. I'm going to get it working some way so that I can then put wire into my DB board to our power company feed into the house, so that when the power company feed dies, this will then illuminate. Obviously can't do it off our main breaker, because our main breaker is always live, because we're either on the inverter or the power company. So this will go direct to the power company, and this will then illuminate, and that'll be our warning then that there is a general power failure, even though we've still got electricity, but it'll be a warning that we need to perhaps be a little more conservative with our power usage. So I'll pop it on the bench and we'll open it up and we'll have a look inside. Right, so let's just have a quick closer look now that we've got this on the bench to see what it is kind of made up of. As you can see, it's got these four LEDs positioned in the top here, and then this whole array. There's this red LED positioned over here, which indicates that it is powered on and charging from the mains. You then have your AC input over here, and then this switch over here. So middle is off. The top would normally just switch on the top set of LEDs. The bottom would switch on the bottom set of LEDs. You'd leave it in that on position. If the power is disconnected, that's when it would illuminate. When the power is connected, that's when it would not illuminate. Then it has this little carry handle on the top here. And it's also got, that's interesting, I actually hadn't realized that it's got this little what looks like DC input on the top here. So what I'm perhaps first going to try and do is I'm going to connect something on there to see if I can power it up, to see if that bypasses the battery inside. So let me just go see if I've got a plug which we can connect in there and see if we can get that working. The one thing to note though, as you can see, there's no screws. What I just started to do prior to deciding to film this, you can see there's a little niche down there. All I did was I got my screwdriver and tweaked that, and that obviously cracked the first bit of glue open. So I've still got the rest to get open, but let me see if I can connect it up to DC and if that works. Right, so I'm in luck. I think I've got a DC plug which will actually fit it. Yeah, okay, it goes in okay. Let's hope it's all making contact. It feels fairly firm. So I'm just going to connect it up to my variable power supply and see if it has brings any life to this. Okay, I'm assuming the center pole on the DC connection is positive. It obviously doesn't say, so I'm just gonna check the polarity on this wire to make sure I get that right. And I can see that it says inside here on a note that it does have, it's a 6-volt, 4-amp-hour lead acid battery inside. So it'll be, I'll start off with 6 volts and see how we go. Okay, so I know the center pole now is the one with the marking on here, which is fairly standard, so I'm assuming we're going to take that, I'm going to set that up as positive. I'm setting my power supply to 6 volts. I'm going to limit it, I'm going to set this in the off position. I'm limiting it to 100 milliamp initially. Okay, I'm going to switch the power supply on now. Ah, it's showing 40, ah, that's interesting. It looks like the LED is on. Let's just check. Yep, and I can hear a relay clicking inside. Okay, that's interesting. There's no current limiting happening on my power supply, so it's not drawing a lot. Certainly not enough to indicate that it'd be charging. And nothing's happening there. Okay, so I'm going to assume it's not charging. Okay, so let's continue and take it apart. Nice little snap. That sorted that out. Another nice little snap. Okay, so that's the lens, and obviously what I've done here, I've gone and broken up these tabs, and guess what? I could have done a far better job of that had I pulled these out by all accounts, because I can already see the pieces in here, so there we go, there's an education for me. Had I just managed to get a screwdriver and then pull these out, I could have got the lens off without snapping the bottom bits off. But not the end of the world, because I can glue it back together. Okay, little plastic bits and pieces flying all over the place. Right, so there we go, we're in. As you can see from the side here, there were these little nibs. So I suppose had I managed to get a screwdriver in there and just pry these sideways, that's how I could have got the lens out. So this is the back end of that whole array of LEDs. That's obviously the LED indicator light. And here is the 6 volt, 4 amp hour a lead acid battery. So I'm obviously guessing that has seen better days. So very, very simple construction then. So simple PC board by all accounts, on little slots here to put it in. There's obviously the main switch. Here is the DC input going through to the back there onto the board. So, and that all slides out. So I'm going to slip it out. My first attempt is what I'm going to do to see if I can get the LEDs operating is to apply 6 volts onto the battery input here and see if we can get it working that way. Heavens, they must have glued the battery in. Okay, so I've managed to remove the one terminal from the battery, the one's right below, and it'll be a bit of a stretch getting there. This board will come out, but these DC leads are holding it in. So I'm just going to undo the DC connector at the back there. There we go. Got the DC plug out at last. Okay, so again, the battery the negative battery onto the PC board is kind of holding things up, so I need to kind of get in there and get it disconnected. Okay, things are still a bit tight with the cables, the AC input. But for the most part we're there. I mean, I can see there are some self-tapping screws going into the AC input down there. They are tucked behind the sticker. So I could pull that off, but I'm just gonna see how close I can get to the task at hand. Okay, the battery's being stubborn. What I'm gonna do right now is, in this state, I'm gonna apply 6 volts onto the battery connectors and see if it'll actually fire up. Okay, so I'm going to apply the switch on my power supply, so I will have the 6 volts. Now I've got it in the off position, have I? Yeah, so in theory it shouldn't come on. Right. Yeehaw! Okay, that's perfect. So at least it's not faulty. It is just this battery which is dead. Now, I have a few options. The most easy, straightforward would be to try and find a replacement 6-volt battery. I do know there's an electronic shop down the road which does sell 6-volt lead acid batteries. I don't know whether they're in this size or in this format. The other thing I was going to try, just because inevitably a battery here, probably with a cheap charging circuit, is always going to eventually die, is I was going to try some of my supercapacitors. So I'm going to get enough of my hybrid capacitors to take a 6-volt charge and see what happens there. What I'm going to do, I'm going to connect the mains and I'm just going to measure what voltage sits at these. Right, so I've just got a mains lead. So what I do is I'm going to connect this up to the mains just to see, just check the voltage which is it's trying to put across or charge the battery with. First of all, what I'm going to do is I'm going to try pull out this battery, for one, just to measure the voltage, just to see if it really is dead. Perhaps even put it on one of my other chargers outside of this to see if I can recover it, and then we'll take it from there. We'll see if I can get some supercapacitors in here and get it up and going. Okay. Okay, so obviously I just had double-sided tape on the inside to keep that in there. So out of interest, let's... Okay, it's certainly not as dead as I thought it might be. I'm actually might be keen to see if I can actually get that to charge. So while I fiddle around with putting the mains, connecting the mains up, I'm actually going to connect it to my variable power supply and just see if it will start taking a charge. And the answer to that is no. I've got this turned up close to 9 volts. No, and the current's not being limited. There's like 7 milliamp going in, so this battery's dead. Okay, so I heard the click, so there's obviously a little relay in there, so the red LED has come on to indicate that it's charging, and we can see it's supplying close to 9 volts. So I need to have enough hybrid or supercapacitors together to make sure that, because obviously hybrid and supercapacitor, the voltage rating on them is fairly low. I think the hybrids I've got are about 2.2, I'll double check. We'll get a few of those together and see if we can hook it up in there. Right, so I've just dug out I've got these hybrid capacitors.
They are rated for 2.3 volts at 220 farad. I've only got three left. The rest are tied up with my Kindle project. So what I'll do, I'm going to perhaps carefully link these up and charge them carefully so that they don't get overcharged on here. Connect them up and see if they'll then operate this light and how long they'd possibly last for. I may have to go nab one back from the Kindle project if I'm going to use the solution. But before we get those all connected up, let's just have a closer look at the PC board. So here we go, here's the PC board. These are soldered on here rather gingerly. The soldering quality is not that great, it's rather messy. It looks like it's a rather quick job. Okay, so here's the top of the board, and now again, I'm not an electronics professional, but let's see if we can kind of make a head or tail of what's going on here. So here we've got the little transformer, which is where the mains, these two wires up here, are coming from the mains plug over there. So that obviously comes up, and then there are some feeds off from there, and I'm assuming that this must be a bridge rectifier. These four diodes over here would be a bridge rectifier. There's a capacitor here. It says 100 micro. Yeah, it's a electrolytic 100 micro, which I presume obviously does some smoothing after the bridge rectifier. And then we've got this 3-watt resistor over here. We've got this resistor over here, which I presume is allowing this LED to run to show that there's actual power connected. This is a 240 volt AC, 28 volt DC relay. So I'm assuming obviously what happens is we get the voltage coming out here. It powers the relay to switch the light off, to keep the light off when you've got mains power. It then also feeds through, it's obviously rectified, and you get straight DC voltage, that 8 or close to 9 volts going through to charge the battery. So there's no charging circuit here. By all accounts, it's just a straight application of a DC voltage onto the battery, which is why obviously those batteries do not last that long. They're not treated very well. It's not a very nice charging system. It merely just takes it up and comes back down. So a very simple circuit. So let me see if I can connect up the hybrid capacitors and get it running off that. Right, so I've got the hybrid capacitors. I'm going to use my little banana clips just to link these up in series and then connect them to the battery terminals here and see if we can get this going. Okay, so I have them all connected up. Let's just check and see if they have got any charge in them. Got 3.2 volts. So I think what I might do, just for fun, is I might actually power this on with the mains to see if it's going to charge these up. I'm going to link up the multimeter to that so we can see what's going on. Right, I've got my multimeter connected. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to connect the mains power again. Cross fingers, nothing goes bang. Okay, there we go. I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to stop this because I want to measure the current that it's actually pushing out through there. So let me unplug it. Right, so let me just describe what I've done. I've obviously got the hybrid capacitors connected in series. There are three of them at 2.3 volts, so that's what, 6.9 volts, call it 7 volts potential there. I've got the Fluke 115 connected so we can read the voltage across them, and the Agilent U1272A is hooked in series to measure the current that's going into these. So now I'm going to plug the power back in again. There we go, I heard the relay click. Okay, so that's putting in close to 260 milliamp.
So I'll let it charge away. The voltage is building across the hybrid capacitors. Okay, so we've reached the point where it's still obviously putting in charge, because remember we said it's sitting at about 8.8 volts. Remember, my hybrid capacitors in their theoretical maximum value should be about 6.9 volts. We're up to 7. I don't want to take them much further because I don't want to damage them. So what we're going to do now, I'm going to pull the power out. I'll receive the LEDs come on, and we'll see how long the LEDs run off this group of hybrid capacitors. So now I've switched the switch from the middle position to the down on position, which in theory should bring this bank on when I remove the power. So now we should get a negative current reading over here, and the voltage should drop. Ah, there you go. So that bank is drawing, 122 milliamp. Let's just switch it up to the top four. There we go. So we've got the top four, and that's a lot less. I mean, that's sitting at 35. Okay, so that's interesting. I'm going to drop it down to the big bank, and let's see how long we can actually run these for. Then, so the one issue I've obviously that's been going through my mind while I've been leaving this discharging is that, fair enough, it's these hybrid capacitors have made this last for half an hour, and it's still going, but it's obviously not going to last several hours, and also at this brightness in the day, I probably wouldn't see these LEDs working. And as I said, I could go and buy another battery and put it in here, but it's going to have the same fate because that charger is just going to kill any battery. So I'm kind of thinking it might be nice to make use of some capacitors, which so that the charging circuit isn't a concern and that they'll last a fairly long time. So then my thinking was, should I put a resistor in to limit the current to help extend the life? So these will burn. This will be a little bit dimmer, but it'll last longer. Then I thought, well, how about making them flash or blink? Because if they blink every so often, then even during the day, there's a good chance they're going to catch your attention. And of course, if they're blinking, they're only going to use a little bit of current when they're actually blinking on. Perhaps making a circuit with a 555 timer or something like that. So I'm going to go away and research that, and also draw the circuit diagram. And that's where I aim to get to with this. So we'll certainly, with this, maybe broken up into two parts, but we'll certainly go through a circuit diagram with this, and then if I manage to get the blinking side of it sorted out to extend the life on these hybrid capacitors, then I'll come back and explain that and show you what I've done there. But let's just see how far this goes anyway. Okay, so we've been going for a fair good old while now. You can see the voltage has dropped down to 5.2 volts. It's only now using 5.1 milliamp. So obviously the brightness of the LEDs is reduced. I just put that over. It's funny, with the cover on, it actually kind of disperses the light. So I think it might remove from the visibility. But anyway, so I'm going to work on that idea of using the 555 timer and actually making it blink. I'm going to disconnect all this now and put a circuit diagram together. And perhaps, if we can, I'll get my UNI-T UT81b scope, and let's just have a look and see what's happening. See if we can have a look what's happening on the circuit. Right here, so I've gone and mapped out a circuit diagram and with some explanation about what's going on. I mean, it is a fairly straightforward and simple circuit, but there's some nice fundamentals to be learned from it. So I'll just point out physically the components again before we have a look at the diagram. As I said, we've got the AC power coming in on these two blue wires here, which is goes to the circuit board, comes that they're picked up by these red wires, which is the primary side of the transformer. Then the secondary side of the transformer comes out onto the board. We've got that then goes to the bridge rectifier, these diodes over here. We've got a smoothing capacitor. We've then got a relay
which is switched to keep the lights off when there's no power, and then when the power is released, it releases, and that allows the LEDs to come on. We've got an LED to show the operation of the circuit. This diode over here goes through to the positive side of the battery to charge it. I'll just point that out to you. I hope the light's all right on this. And then, so that goes through to the positive of the battery. This resistor here feeds the energizer side of the relay. And then the DC input actually goes through this whopping 3-watt resistor to feed it, so you can feed it with DC. But anyway, so those are the physical components. Let's just see how it's mapped out. Rightio, so here we go. We've got the live and the neutral coming in through that primary side of the transformer. Then out of the secondary side, it feeds into this bridge rectifier. So a bridge rectifier, and this is something I said I'll go into more detail when we do the electronics tutorial. But the bridge rectifier, you've obviously got AC alternating, going back and forth like that. So when the AC is coming in this direction, this diode is reverse biased. This diode over here is forward biased, so that feeds out here down that line. And obviously, you've got the converse on the negative side. You've got the flow going, so you've got a circuit flowing down through that diode, through the circuit here, back up, and around through the transformer. When the AC is going around the other way, we then have it flowing up here through this diode, through the circuit, down, round, up, and out that way. So as you can see, you still that's how you get your rectification through the circuit over here. And I'm going to go through the what it looks like, and we'll actually do the measurements and have a look at that. We've then got this capacitor on the output over here, because we've got our positive side here, our negative here, on the second, on the side of the bridge rectifier, and that does some smoothing for us. Then up here, we've got that DC input I was talking about, and the 22 ohm, it's a 22 ohm 3-watt resistor over here, going crossing our positive and our negative rail. We've then got over here, what we've got a, this was a if I recall correctly, I forget, I didn't actually take work out what the resistance was of that resistor, but there's a resistor in series with a light emitting diode to show that the circuit is operational over here. Then we come out, and this is where the relay is energized on this side, and part of the feed to the relay goes through a 33 ohm resistor. So that energizes that. You can also see here, this is the takeoff down here through this diode goes through to the positive side of the 6-volt battery, which sits over here. So that's what charges it. It's obviously there, so there's no feedback to the circuit over here, or no leakage. So the battery doesn't leak back through the circuit, but yeah, so no charging circuit at all. So when this circuit is energized, it then releases, it releases the switch, so the circuit is off. And when the power is removed, the relay closes, which then forms a circuit over here with a battery to power up the banks of LEDs. And there's a switch, you either switch on to this bank of LEDs, the bigger bank of LEDs over there, or you switch it, you've got a middle position for off, or a position over here, which then feeds the four LEDs over here. And literally, it's as simple as that. It's very straightforward. But what becomes more interesting is what happens with the kind of waveforms on the different parts of the circuit. So let's see if we can have a look at that quickly. So at the front of the circuit over here, you've got your mains coming in. And now your mains peaks, I'm going to show you the measurements on both my Fluke multimeter, and we'll have a look with the UT UT81b scope. Unfortunately, my big scope isn't working, but the UT81b seems to be doing a good job. So on the input over here, we represented on a what would look like an oscilloscope output here, we have an alternating current going through a positive cycle, negative, and then back up to positive. It's peaking at around 317 volts, negative 317, for an average about 230 volt RMS. So that's the average voltage of that alternating current coming through there. That's through the primary circuit. Now this transformer I worked out has got roughly a 24.7 to 1 ratio. So it divides the incoming AC voltage to an outgoing secondary AC voltage by 24.7 times. So that means on the secondary windings of the transformer, you've still got a AC waveform, it's still 50 hertz, the same 50 hertz that you're putting in, you're not changing the frequency, but it's been reduced to a peak of about 13.5 positive to negative 13.5, and that gives you an average of about 9.3 volts AC RMS coming out the secondary part. Then of course we go through the bridge rectifier. Now what the bridge rectifier does, as I said, you realize with it pushing through that bridge rectifier, you're pushing through the circuit, which always keeps your waveform positive. So you've basically flipped your waveform around this side and you're getting two positive waveforms coming out. What does that mean? It means that your frequencies actually increase. So here you've got 100 hertz. Because your cycle is now happening twice after coming through the output of that rectifier. And then what happens, but obviously ultimately what you're trying to achieve on this side is a reduced voltage at DC, not AC. So we've obviously got the reduction and we've got it all positive now, but it's certainly not a very nice voltage coming out because it's got a lot of ripple, it's got a lot of bumps in it. So that's where the smoothing capacitor comes in. We've got this electrolytic capacitor across the output of the bridge rectifier. The one here happens to be 100 microfarad. Now, if you get bigger capacitors, you can smooth far better. And I reckon if we did change that, we'd have better smoothing. So when you smooth it, what happens is when you get the positive cycle up here, the capacitor charges, and then when it dips down here, you get a discharge on the capacitor starts feeding the rest of the circuit as it discharges. And obviously then you get the cycle again charging, which charges the capacitor. And then when your AC goes down, your capacitor is slowly discharging and that's feeding the circuit. So what you end up with is a kind of ripple effect up here. You don't go right down to negative, but you have this ripple sitting up at your voltage level. Now the voltage level over here is 11.5, down from the 13.5, roughly. And those losses are because you've got your forward bias drops across two diodes. So the losses across two diodes for your bridge rectifier means you lose some of the voltage over here, and then we end up with this 11.5 nice 100 hertz ripple on this side, and then that obviously goes through to power the rest of the circuit. It's not a very clean regulated voltage, no battery regulation. It's a very cheaply, horribly put together circuit since I've been looking at it closer, but there you go. So let's get the multimeter out and we'll actually have a look at these measurements on the different stages. Right, again, so I hope the lighting will be all right. As I said, I'm still playing around with the new camera and my lighting, so hopefully you'll be able to see what's going on. I've got my Fluke 287 here. I've got the UNI-T 81b here so we can see the waveform. What I'm gonna do, I'm gonna plug the circuit in so it's live. Now I've got my 287 set to AC volts. What I'm going to do here, I'm going to set it. It's got a nice feature where you can set it to see the peak. So you get to see the RMS value and the peak of an AC wave. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to now measure the input of the circuit. So that at the primary of the transformer, So that's the primary cross here. That's where we're measuring now. Right, Okay, so as you can see, I said about 317 or so. It obviously picks up as it rushes in. It might hit a different peak and a different minimum, but you can see the peak max is 314, the peak min is minus 321, and the average RMS reading there is about 229 is what we're getting. So that's across the primary. So that relates to what I was showing you on that first drawing. I'll just bring that up again. So here, that's what we're measuring over here. Those are the two peaks that you saw. That's the waveform, which I'll show you now, and then that's the RMS reading. So let's have a look and see what that looks like as a waveform on the UNI-T. Hopefully it's going to play ball for us. There we go. So if you look at the, and hopefully you can see that clearly enough. I'm not sure if you can. I'm short of hands. But at the top you can see it's showing that each block, each graduation is 100 volts per division. And you can see the 50 hertz. And you can see the nice AC sine wave that's formed there. So that's what we would expect to see on the input. Okay, so now let's go look at the secondary of the transformer. And the secondary of the transformer, I just have to get my eyes in to make sure I'm in the right place. So what I need to do is restart that. So now we're looking at the Fluke. And there we go. We're getting our RMS, our secondary side, the 9.3 volts AC with a peak of 13 point something positive and about 13.4 negative. That's on the secondary side. Just to go back and show you, so that's on the secondary side over here, and that's what I was saying over here. We've now got our reduced AC voltage out the transformer. So that's what we're doing. We're stepping down from the high AC voltage to the low AC voltage, but we've obviously still got our nice 50 hertz sine wave happening. Right, so now let's go and have a look at that on the UNI-T. And there we go. You can see now volts per division is 5 volts. I can see about two and a bit divisions there. So, because we're looking, yeah, close to 3. So that gives us about the 13 we're talking about and still at 50 hertz. But that's the reduced sine wave on the secondary side of that transformer. Now, obviously, the what you're seeing there, that's the secondary side. Now we've got to go through the bridge rectifier. So this time I'm not going to use the Fluke. I'm going to just stay with the UNI-T. Let me just show you on the diagram. So that's what we've seen now on the UNI-T, is that wave. That's on that side, and now we're going to have a look on this side of the bridge rectifier, bearing in mind that that capacitor is in place. So because that capacitor is in place, we're not going to see this waveform. We're potentially going to see that. And there you go. So on the UNI-T there, you can see all those little waveforms. Now, obviously, there's a lot more in there because it's scaled to fit more in. But you can see it's got the raised ripple at the top there. We've got about 9.4, 9.5 RMS voltage. But the volts per division is set at 5, and I can see about 11 and a bit. Yeah, so about 11.5 I'm looking down there. So it's certainly doing what it should do, and that is literally how that circuit works. It's very straightforward, and I must say it's quite handy having a little scope so you can see how all those little parts of the circuit are doing their little bit. If we did remove that capacitor, then we should get a waveform looking like that. So I tell you what, for a laugh, let's see if I'll remove the capacitor and see if we get that. Right, so there we go. The capacitor is removed, so I'm going to hook it all up again and we'll take a measurement and see what that does to the waveform. Okay, so this time hopefully I've got you in a little bit closer so you can see what's going on. I'm going to go back to the primary winding again. There we go, it's 100 volts per division. There's just over two divisions there, 50 hertz. Now we'll go to the secondary. And there we go, that's right as well. Still at 50 hertz. And that's at our about roughly 13.5 volts. So now what I'm expecting to see after the bridge rectifier is that kind of camel hump. There you go. And that's exactly what we're expecting to see as per the diagram. So you've gone and turned, you've upped the frequency. Whoops, I just slipped off there. Up the frequency. And when the capacitor's in there, then you're riding on top of those humps, basically smoothing out those humps as I explained earlier. So what for fun, I'm going to see if I've got a bigger value capacitor to see if it does anything any better smoothing. Okay, so I've got a 1,000 microfarad capacitor. I don't know if you can see that, so the focus of this camera. It's 1,000 microfarad. So I'm going to stick that in, and I don't know, we'll see. I don't know whether we'll be able to see whether it's actually smoothed it out and not as ripply as it was. So I'll put that in now and let's see if we can see a difference. Okay, so I've inserted it. I don't intend to leave it there, so I've only just done it roughly, but it's inserted. Just applying the AC again, and let's see if we can tell if there's any difference. Of course, it would be nicer to have a bigger scope and more hands to perhaps try and measure. Look at that. Now, let me get that going again. Well, I don't know if you can see that, but in my mind that is significantly better than what it was previously. Now, it looks, yeah, it's scaled to 20 millivolts and 5 volts, so the scale is the same as the previous one, as I recall, and that certainly isn't as lumpy and bumpy as the previous output. So it just shows you what a decent smoothing capacitor can do. You can get a far better, far closer to DC than what it was previously. Okay, and just for fun, this is probably more for me than anyone else. I've put the old capacitor back. I just wanted to see that output again, just as a comparison. So the older capacitor back. And there you go. Certainly a difference. And again, the scaling is correct. We're at 5 volts and 20 milliseconds. So you can see what a difference the large capacitor made on the smoothing of that so-called DC output. Okay then, I hope you really enjoyed that first kind of take a look inside series. I actually really enjoyed it myself. It's actually turned night since I started doing it. It took a bit of time kind of tracing through the circuit and putting that all together, but I actually really enjoyed it. It was a good exercise for me. As I said, this isn't really my forte, but I had a reason to want to actually sit and work on this so that we've got some alerting system for when the our mains feed goes out and we're not aware of it. So if you do enjoy it, please give us a thumbs up. It'll give me an indication that you'd like to see more of these. I think the kind of electronic fundamentals and tracing through what's going on is really great. I must say, I'm also really impressed by the UNI-T UT81b. It certainly has its weaknesses. It's a very entry-level scope, but just for looking at bits and pieces like that and see what's going on, it does the job. Of course, I'd like to have a nice big scope where I could play around and capture waves and what have you, but that actually is doing the job for now. So what I'll do, if you're keen, I'll follow up with a second part to this where I
put together some kind of circuit to make the lights blink or flash to reduce the power consumption, to see if I can run it off. My aim is for around four to eight hours I'd like to run it for. So that's the challenge, is can setting a frequency blink on the lights make it more efficient so I can run it longer. There you go. So again, I thank you very much for watching, and I'll catch you soon for the next video. Cheers.